Many people come to me, they call me, they chat me, and they say, man of God, help me, I'm in sin. I want to serve God, I can't. The cure is priesthood. I'm living in sin. There's nothing I can do about it. The cure is priesthood. It's not the prayer of a man of God. Then they pour a drum of oil on you, you will still live in secrecy. I want to do the will of God. The cure is priesthood. Did you read the life of Jesus? He leaves a crusade and the next thing he goes to the top of the mountain and prays all night. People are gathered to hear him. He escaped through the back door and he goes to the mountain to pray all night. The Bible says early in the morning, before the cool of the day, he went to a solitary place where he prays. Why do you think Jesus was the way he was? He understood priesthood. He was not mighty because he was the Son of God. You and I are also the Son of God. The difference between you and Jesus is priesthood. His priesthood. His priesthood. The difference is priesthood. Many are not men that order. Follow the order of priesthood. Priesthood. Shakakata. You want your life to turn around? It's priesthood. Most of us are prophets. We are apostles. We are mighty politicians, leaders, generals. But we will never enter there. It's by priesthood. In this kingdom, there's one way to prosper. It's called priesthood. Because only priests live in the kingdom. The kingdom was not designed for disciples. It was not designed for sons. It was not designed for friends. It was not designed for servants. It was designed for priests. He said, unto you, unto him that have washed us and made us kings and priests. Unto him that have washed us and made us kings and priests. He said, I will make you a kingdom of priests and kings. If you are not a king, if you are not a priest, you can't live in this kingdom. You may be the friend of God, that's beautiful, but the kingdom is not for friends. You may be the servant of God, that's great, but the kingdom is not for servant. You may be the wise son of God, that's beautiful, but the kingdom is not for soul. The kingdom is for priests and kings. That's why your life is not working. You want your life to begin to walk, you must come to the gates of Zion. What is priesthood? Priesthood is the ability to connect to heaven on earth. Priesthood is the ability to wield the powers of heaven on earth. Priesthood is kingdom legislation and litigation. Your ability to move the kingdom forward is what we call priesthood. Your ability to judge the works of darkness on earth as a custodian of the authority of heaven is what we call priesthood. How do you get into that authority? The first thing is that God must walk himself into you. If God is not walked into a man, the man cannot walk God out. Only men whom God is walked into can walk God out. There are many Christians who are calling God, talking the name of God, and with titles, they only bring reproach to the name of God. Because when a principality shows up, they become a puppet. A puppet. A puppet. A puppet. Because they don't know the way of priesthood. They don't know the way of priesthood. Kingdom legislation. Kingdom legislation begins with you. That's why I told you, the moment you enter the courts, the first thing you see is the altar of sacrifice. That's when you die. Tell somebody, you must die. You must die. You see that your ambition of becoming Miss Nigeria, you must die. That your ambition of becoming the first pilot from Edo, you must die. That your ambition of becoming the richest man, you must die. Tell somebody, you must die. When you die to self, even when you become the richest man, your money is not for show. Your money becomes a trust that is used to advance the kingdom. When you die, if you become the most beautiful woman, it will not be a pageant. It will be an avenue to reach out to people. When you die, everything you have become a kingdom resource, and your life itself become a kingdom arsenal. You become an artillery, a garrison of God. Every time God wants to fight, all he needs to do is to fetch into you. And he will bring out a grenade. All he needs to do is to fetch it to you. He will bring out a double barrel. Because you are dead. Your hand is an extension of God. Your mouth is an extension of God. Your thought is an extension of God. Your words are extensions of God. That's why the apostles prayed. They said that you may stretch forth thy hands through us. They understood something. They are dead to flesh. So when they stretch their hand becomes the hand of God. When Moses stretched his rod becomes the rod of God. Because the man had understood the economy of death. Once upon a time, Moses was happy that he was the prince of Egypt. Once upon a time, Moses was happy that he was the son of Pharaoh's daughter. when the Bible said when Moses was come of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to suffer affliction with the people of God. This guy left the palace as a prince. He went into the wilderness and became a shepherd for many years. But when he came back, the Bible said in Exodus chapter 7 verse 1, he said, "Behold, I have made you a god unto Pharaoh." If he was in Egypt, he would have been a prince in the courts of Pharaoh. But he went to the backside of the desert. He understood the will of death. And he returned. Instead of a prince, he became a god. It's called the way of priesthood. The way of priesthood. Demons will mess your family up until priesthood rises on your inside. Some come, they say, "Hey, there are four of us. My elder sister is 35. The second one is 33. I am 31. The other one is 29. We are not getting married." There's a demon correlated over your family. What that demon needs is not the intervention of God. It's the rise of a priest. Because God has intervened. But there's no man on earth to say, "Restore. Restore. Restore. Restore." It's the way of priesthood. That appetite you will not give up is your grave. Satan will put an appetite in your hand. That appetite will become your grave. Some of us, Facebook is our grave. WhatsApp is our grave. Instagram is our grave. Some of us, shoes are our grave. Our looks is our grave. The mascara is your grave because it has become your God. You must give up the appetite if you will reign among men. It's called the way of priesthood. The way of priesthood. The way of priesthood. You die on the altar of sacrifice. You hold on to the horn of the altar until you give up your ambition. I graduated from the university in 2011. My goal was to be a military officer. But the day the letter came to become a naval officer, that time I had died. Because as a military officer, I will only move with pride, with all the ranks. But as a preacher, I will change the lives of millions. Today, there are many thousands, tens of thousands. They call me every morning to seek the direction for their lives. That is not a platform I could have as a naval officer. I choose the way of death. Some of you is politics, but if you don't die before you get there, you will become the next corruption of Nigeria. But if you die, the story about you will be told like Jesus in the land of Zebulun, in the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentile, the people that sat in darkness, behold, they have seen a great light. When you enter into the political corridor, you will not be a governor, you will be the witness of Zion. You will be the important pillar that is instituted to bring witness to the name of Jesus. The people that were looting money, when they look at you, they will run away. But you will the way of priesthood. Some of you are in a room with people who are lesbians, club addicts. Instead of changing them, they change you. You came in 100 level as a decent lady, but now you are the slave queen because there's no priesthood in your life. You have become a puppet in the hand of Jezebel. The Leviathan has caught you and you can no longer be relevant. But if you will change your steps tonight and hug the altar of sacrifice, things can change because it's never too late with Jesus. He was the one that factored your being. The dimensions of your spirit, he designed it in the theater. He fashioned you, he formed you. He knows your abilities, your proclivities, your attitudinalities. He knows it because he designed you. Any day you come back, he can beam on you the light of his glory. And as we behold, we are changed. As we behold, we are changed. Then suddenly, a harlot becomes an evangelist. Suddenly, a criminal becomes a prophet. Why? Because as we behold, we are changed. As we look upon him, we are changed. When you look at me, you no longer see a man. You see Christ in me, the hope of glory. Because it is the mystery of the age that mere mortals will become custodians of the dimensions of the immortal spirit. That mere mortals will become the proof that God is real. That mere mortals will become the extension of the corridors of Zion to the natural world. It is the man who accepts the way of priesthood. The way of priesthood. The way of priesthood. The sacrifice will cost you hunger. It will cost you money. It will cost you hours of prayer. You will give up friends. You will give up many things. I had many friends in the university. They called me Skywide because I was a football analyst. I knew all the records of Arsenal. I know when they were founded. I know all the matches they played. I could quote you a match in 1976 when they played the Champions League match. I could tell you everyone that won the Champions League for 100 years. But something happened when the light of God beamed upon me. I dropped the flesh. I dropped the appetite. I dropped the ways of the world so that I could become a proof that God is alive. You hear him, he becomes like an immortal. He speaks and you no longer sleep. Your sleep is taken away from you because his voice is not just a product of mental intelligence. His voice is an echo from Zion. There are men that speak and they are amplifiers to the voice of God. They are amplifiers. Every time God wants to speak, they show up. They show up. And then you hear in the scriptures, he said, the word of the Lord came to me. The guy was in the cave. He was in the wilderness. But God wants to talk in the palace. And suddenly the anointing carries him. And he shows up. And he said, the word of the Lord came to me. That means there's nobody in the palace that can traffic the voice of God. The voice of God will be scarce unless that man shows up. He is the connector between eternity and earth. He is the connector between the spirit realm and the natural. Why? Because he embraced the altar of sacrifice. That desire, that appetite you are holding on to, that is what will kill you. It's an intelligence of the demonic to make you irrelevant forever. And when time is accomplished, you will realize that 100 years is like a moment in eternity. Moses looked upon the veils and the vistas of eternity were open. And in the matter of 40 days, Moses saw everything that happened before God began to create the world. And he saw the things that will happen when he dies. Why? Because life is a moment. If the windows of eternity are open to you, you can see what will happen in the next 100 years. Does that not suggest to you that you don't waste your life? You think you are living for 80 years and you think it's long life. No, no, no. What counts is not long life. What counts is the life that is in your days. Many are weak. Many are beggarly. Many are puppets because they have not embraced the way of Christ. The altar of sacrifice. This is not a doctrine. This is you yielding consistently to the progressive instructions of the Holy Ghost. It tells you today, no food, no food. No Facebook for 1 month, no Facebook for 1 month. It's called the altar of sacrifice. And until you embrace the altar of sacrifice, you are not a reasonable Christian. Paul said, you dearly beloved, presenting your body as a living sacrifice. When you begin to do that, then you become a reasonable Christian. There are many unreasonable people walking in the courts of God. Many unreasonable people. When God wants to speak, their mouth is sealed. When God wants to give, their pocket is sealed. When God wants intercession to rise to heaven, they are sleeping and slumbering on their bed. They have not embraced the way of sacrifice. And until sacrifice becomes the organogram of your life, you have no future with God. When you journey past the altar of sacrifice, you come to the lava. It is in the lava that the sanctifying power of the Holy Ghost begins to work. In the lava, you have the waters of the Spirit. It begins to wash you. Yes, yes, yes. You were a smoker. You were a smoker. You desire to smoke. You were raped when you were a child. So you have become lustful concerning sex. When you come to the altar, the lava, then the Holy Ghost begins to wash your soul. And like the psalmist, you will say, the Lord restoreth my soul. So suddenly, a woman who does not see handsome men and go away, or a man who does not see fair ladies and turn his eyes, even if a naked one stands, he doesn't notice. Why? The lava, he has been washed. He said, that thou mightest cleanse her by washing with water, by the word of God. That's the function of the lava. Before the priest enter the inner courts to carry the axe of priesthood, he must be washed in the lava. You must be washed. It is a washing, the sanctification of the Holy Spirit. This is not a doctrine. This is an organic life. You come to that point where the Holy Ghost purges you every morning. Every morning, you hear his voice. Every morning, he speaks to you. And from the whispers of the Spirit, he tells you what to do. Jesus said, the words I have spoken to you, they have washed you. There's a technology in God where your soul can be restored. You know, psychologists said the soul can never be restored. A man who have had sex before, he had had an experience of sin. No matter how he tries, that thing is like a backdrop. Do you see this thing? This is a backdrop. There's no way you will look at me and you will not see this backdrop. A man who have gained experiential knowledge of sin, that sin becomes a backdrop. The only thing that will remove that backdrop is the sanctifying power of the Holy Spirit. That's why we seek him every morning in prayer. Every morning, we go to him and we say, Lord, wash us. Cleanse us afresh. Because there is a service that we must carry out. It's called the sanctifying power of the Holy Ghost. There are many who don't have a relationship with the Holy Ghost because they are afraid. When you come there, he will tell you the things you don't want to do. Maybe the first thing he will tell you is, don't make up again. Ah! The lady has barbed all her eyelashes. So if she doesn't do the artificial makeup, she will become like a baboon. But the Holy Ghost say, no makeups again. If you will travel deep with God, that will become the compass of your life. We don't go deeper in the spirit because we read the Bible. We go deeper in the spirit because we obey the voice of God. I leave the earth to worship you. I leave the earth to worship you. I leave the earth to worship you. No one else like you. No one beside you. I leave the earth to worship you. When you complete this process, what has happened is that your flesh has been tamed. This time you can now go and serve the living God. You know, Paul said you should be reasonable. Everything that Paul wrote in Romans chapter 1 to Romans chapter 11 is about the finished works of Jesus. From Romans 1 to Romans 9 to Romans 8, he reveals to you what Jesus did for you. How that the cross paid for your sin. How that the blood washes your sin away. And how that you don't need anything to be the righteousness of God. From Romans 9 to Romans 11, he reveals what Jesus did to save the Jews. But from Romans 12, he tells you what you must do. That place is a place of service. When the Holy Ghost succeeds in taming your flesh, then you come to the inner courts. It's in the inner courts that you begin to strengthen the soul. Because the soul doesn't understand the ways of God. So the first thing you meet is called the table of shewbread. Did you remember in Luke, when they were journeying through the path of Emmaus, the Bible said as he broke the bread, their eyes opened and they recognized him, that he was the Christ. There are many of you that read the Bible today, it's like a novel. You are trying to read it, you can't understand it, you don't know why. You read, then you sleep off. Every time you try to read, it's okay, from now, I will read the Bible. And then you carry the Bible, you begin to read, and it doesn't make sense. The reason it doesn't make sense is because the man who can open the scripture is the man that his flesh has been tamed. A disobedient man to the Holy Ghost cannot obey the scripture because the spirit is called the spirit of revelation. Paul said, I pray for you in the church of Ephesians. He said that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened. Be enlightened. The word is fortizo. Fortizo. The Lord opens the scriptures for you. So when you open it, it becomes sweet. That's when you read the Bible and it's sweet. You hear the word of God and it's sweet. Something has happened. Your soul has been reconfigured. The Bible said in Jeremiah 15:16, it said, I found thy word. I did eat them and they became the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. If the word of God doesn't make sense, it's because you are disobedient. The moment your obedience is fulfilled and you enter into the inner court, you confront the altar of shewbread, and the bread of life begins to open. And as you eat it, you become strong. That's when you go out. You see your friends that you go to club with for the past 4 years, and they say, man, today is Friday, we go purple. And you say, no, I don't feel like going. You know why? The appetite is dead. That appetite was the mask that hosted that demon that regulated your life. But the appetite is dead. You are not trying to use discipline. No, no, no. The appetite is no longer there. Somebody comes to you and say, oh boy, I'm going to go watch match. I'll go buy you 3 bottles of beer. You go flex. And then you say, beer. I don't want to take beer. It becomes bitter. Why? The appetite is dead. These were things you could do anything for. But now the appetite is dead.
Whatever that is, show your grace. That is magnifying self in me. Whatever doesn't look like you, that is still reflecting in me. Whatever doesn't show your grace, that is magnifying self in me. Take it away, oh. Take it away. It's a heart cry, it's not a song. It's a heart cry. Is a heart cry. Is a heart cry. Is a heart cry. Don't come, don't come, don't come, don't come, don't come, don't come. Can your heart cry? Can you let your heart cry? Let everyone hear. Take it away. Take it away.